Okay, good afternoon to everyone. So yesterday we completed the topic of differential calculus and maxima and minima. Today we'll be dealing with the second branch of calculus which I mentioned, which is integral calculus. Now, before we go on to integral calculus, we need to know the knowledge of what do I mean when I say area under a curve. So as I told you yesterday, even a line counts as a curve. So let me say I have such a line. Now, what I mean when I say the area under this curve means, like, so you can see this terminal point of the line. If I drop a perpendicular from it to the x-axis, then the area of this triangle is referred to as the area of the curve. And if it's a line which has a certain intercept, then we drop a perpendicular and it's the area of this trapezium, which we say is the area under the curve. Now, we know when we are dealing with lines by certain formulae which should have been provided by us. For example, the formula for the area of a triangle, parallelogram, trapezium, rectangle. From all those formulae, we can easily deduce what is the area of a certain line. But what can we do if we have a curve? Simply, you can say that maybe we can put some rectangle. So, or triangle. I can put a triangle over here, then a rectangle over here, triangle, rectangle. So, if we keep doing that, what the problem in this method is that there will be some error. Since it's a curved shape, there will be some error in our measurement of the area. So what can we do to stop this error? Actually, we cannot stop this error, of course, because it's a curve. And if we use rectangles or triangles or any shape, what we say modules, for representing the area of this curve, it will have some error. But our aim will be to minimize that error. If it is inevitable, then our aim is to minimize that error. So, to minimize that error, now all of you know what I mean when I say dy and dx. So, let's take this curve. And as you know, like I told you yesterday, we cannot represent distance like dy and dx on our board. So, what I will actually be showing is just a magnified version. So, if I take small rectangles, whose length it can be taken as y and their width can be taken as dx, then mathematically, what we can say is the area of this curve will be a certain expression. For example, what I mean by that is, let me explain what I mean. The area under the curve will be, let me take that area as A. So that area will be, we use something called summation. Of course, it will be the sum of all the areas of the small rectangles whose length is Y and width is dx. So it will be the first triangle. What you're doing is basically, and you know the area of the rectangle, it's Y dx. So summation from I is equal to 1. I is equal to 1 when we are writing summations and those. That means how many times I'll be taking. For example, if I have taken, say, n bars, I write I is equal to n and then y dx. Because obviously, you know by the rectangle formula, L length into breadth, that this will be, the area of each rectangle will be y dx. So we write it as summation. But to make our job easier, instead of carrying this symbol every time, we use another mathematical expression called integration of y dx. That is basically what I mean when I say integration. Basically, it's a summation of small parts which cannot be represented exactly. I mean, this is a very difficult symbol to carry every time writing summation, I is equal to 1, n, and then the expression, which itself may be vague, and y dx. Instead, our job has been made easier, and it's written with this symbol, which is referred to as the symbol of integration. So that is what it means graphically. What is integration of y dx? Just like yesterday, what we did when we drew a table to represent certain values of if we have y as a function of x or fx and dy by dx. Similarly, we have a table which we follow for integration. So let me draw that. We have over here, if this column is y, then this will be y dx integration. So like yesterday again, first let me write all the functions on this side. Sin x, cos x, and then slowly when I'm done with this, I will write the other functions. Sin x square x, cos x square x. Then we have sec x tan x. I think we also have cosec x cot x. That's not it, there are a few more. Then we have x raised to n 1 by x. And then two more, since they'll not be visible down, I'll write those two over here, which are 1 by x square plus a square and 1 by the root of a square minus x square. Now, starting with the values. Minus cos x, sin x, tan x, minus of cot x, sec x, minus of cos x, x raised to n plus 1 divided by n plus 1, ln x, 1 by a into tan inverse x by a, and finally sine inverse x by a. Now, if you go back, first of all, note down this table. And what I want you to do is go back to the table you drew for dy by dx, because what will happen is you'll find a similarity. Go back to your table for differential integrals. Derivatives. Okay, let me give you two examples which you can see. You know that d tan x by dx is 6 squared. And here you can also see that integration of sec square x dx is equal to tan x. Similarly, another example I can give is for, let's go to sin x. So what we had learned yesterday was d of cos x by dx is minus of sin x. Here another thing we are learning is integration of cos x. Wait, just a minute. Integration of, okay, sin x dx is minus cos x. So you can see a pattern, but what exactly is happening? Let me explain. So let me say that dy by dx is equal to a. What you do is bring dx up. Dy is equal to a dx. Now, since they are the same expression, what we can do is integrate both the sides, we'll get y is equal to integration of a dx. Now in integral calculus, we have two types of integrals to deal with. Definitive integrals and indefinite integrals. What are definitive and indefinite integrals? Let me explain. Okay. So, have all of you noted down this table? Riyansh, Ajinkya, have you noted down this table? Both of you, can you reply, please? Am I audible?
Yes, done.
Okay, fine. So, if you have noted down this table, I'll erase it. Have you noted down this table? I'll give you just one more minute to note this down, note down this table. 125. Okay, so I think you've noted down this table, so I'm erasing this. Now we go to indefinite. So as I told in the previous exam, if dy by dx is a. Now let me take that example, dy by dx is a. Now let me take y is equal to x raised to 3 plus c. Where c is a constant. Constant of integration, in fact, we call it. So, d of y by dx will be d of x cubed plus the constant of integration by dx. And you know that if you have sum, then you can do d of x cubed by dx, dx cubed by dx, plus dc by dx. You know that the differentiation of a constant is 0, so this term will turn out to 0. And finally, what you will get is 2x squared. That is what you will be getting. Okay? Now what you can do over here is something which is very tricky, you can say. You got this as 2x squared plus 0. So that you can understand easier. Then what you can get is integration of d of x cubed plus c is equal to integration of 2x squared dx. That is what you know. And then similarly, you can get x raised to 3 plus c is equal to integration of 2x squared dx. But the problem with indefinite integrals is you don't know whether you should add constant of integration to a term or not, because integration of 2x squared will 2x squared dx will be 2x cubed by 3. Wait, I think I have completed there. All of you should notice, by the way, still, it should be 3x squared, this should be 3x squared, and this should be 3x squared. So you know that from the formula d of x raised to n by dx, that this should be x raised to n plus 1 by n plus 1, which means this will be x cubed by 3. And when there's a constant in integration also, you can make the constant go up, which means integration of 3x squared dx can be 3 into integration of x squared dx. X squared dx from that formula you learned is 3 into x cubed by 3. So this will get you x. But d of c means that you know is 0, but still you don't know whether the function is x cube or x cube plus c, because somehow it's getting you the same result. What does that mean in this case is, this means that during integration, the constant does not appear. It is due to the fact that the differential, it's due to that fact that the differential coefficient of a constant is 0. Means dy by dx of any constant is 0. That is what that means. So we cannot definitely say whether the integration of 5x raised to 4, I mean, if we, in this case, it was 3x squared. So if I take even 5x raised to 4, we don't know whether it's x raised to 5, or x raised to 5 plus c. Right? So such an integration is known as indefinite integration. Basically, what you actually should do is, if there are no limits to an integration, what are limits? I'll tell you later. If it's just given the integration symbol and any function x, then you then let the let this be I, you, if there's no limits, you should always add the constant of integration plus c. Okay? So a few more formulae for integration are as shown below. As I told you, integration of a constant c into fx dx can also be said as c into fx dx. That is one of the other formulae. Then we also have that let integration of fx dx be fx. If we then, what will be the cases? Fnx dx will be f into, or not only n, you can say like we put over here c, where c is a constant, as you know, but remember this c is not the cost of integration. Cost of integration is different, that you put when you're finding integrals which don't have limits. This is just any constant c, and if you put f cx dx, you will get f into cx by c. What do I mean with this rule? So you know from the integral statement that the integration of sine x dx should be minus of cos x plus c. But if I ask you what will be the integration of sine of 3x dx, this will be, from this rule, minus of cos of 3x by 3 plus c. So that is basically what I mean by this final rule. And the third rule is simple. If you have any two functions, for example, let's say your two functions are fx and gx, you have to find dx. Then simply you can do integration of fx dx plus integration of gx dx. Now, that was for some more formula of integration and indefinite integrals. What are definite integrals now? Let us move on. So, basically, what I mean when I say definite integrals, let me take an example, okay? Let me say, I have written over here an 8 and over here a 10. And what I want to do is integrate y square with respect to 1. Okay. So by the formula, which says that integration of x raised to n dx is equal to integration of, not integration of, is equal to x raised to n plus 1 by n plus 1. Since this has no limit, plus c also. But over here, there are limits. This is called lower limit. This is called upper limit. How do they make a change? Let's see. So from this formula, you know that this should be y cubed by 3. Now, when there are limits, very important, never put a constant of integration when you have limits. That cannot be put if you have limits. So, y cubed by 3. Now, how this plays a role is upper limit minus lower limit, which means if I've got your y cubed by 3, what I can do is 10 cubed minus 8 cubed by 3. This is what the limits mean. Got it, Ajinkya? Riyansh, both of you got it? Okay, I think you
got
it.
No, sir, I have doubt. Can you repeat it?
See, if I take any function, which part aren't you getting and which part are you not getting? Tell me which part are you having doubt in. Then only I can clear, right? Only if you tell me your doubt. Yeah, tell. Which part?
I didn't even understand the whole question and answer.
See, it wasn't a... the whole integration you didn't get.
Yes, sir.
You got the first part when I said that there is a curve and you can only take rectangles of small bit dx, right?
Yes, sir.
And there will be integration of y dx. Then I made you write that table.
Yes,
indefinite
sir.
Integrals, you always have to add constant. Constant basically means, for example, at that time, let's say, I'll take an example, cos x square x. So integration of cos x square x, if you look at your, with respect to x, if you look at your table, that will have a value of minus of cot x. But since there are no limits, we always add a constant of integration, capital C. Now got it?
Sure.
Always. Never forget, if there are no limits, if there is nothing written up and down, this integral sign, you have to add an integration constant. Okay?
Yeah, yes, sir.
Okay. But if there are limits, okay, if y square you didn't get, let me take, now, for example, let the function be y dy, let the limits be 3 and 2. So, see, don't get confused if I say y when I have told you formula leading to x, because x will represent any variable you take. If I take z, if I take z raised to n and integrate z n dz, then it will be z raised to n plus 1 divided by n plus 1. That is just a general formula. It's only a general form. So, if you look at your table, you know that integration of x raised to n dx is equal to x raised to n plus 1 divided by n plus 1. So what that actually means is, see, you know from exponents and powers that y can be nothing but, I can write it, I can rewrite it as y raised to 1 into dy. And from this, you know, this formula, that this should be y raised to 1 plus 1 divided by 1 plus 1. Now, when there are limits, you write one vertical line, a big vertical line, and then write the limits which you want. 3. Okay, this is wrong. You can put 3 and 2 over here, but that will give you a negative result. Still, 3 and 2 means, I'm not saying that it's wrong, but usually they put the bigger one more. Okay, to make you understand, I'll take 3 and 2 only. So, 3 over, no, 2 over here and 3 over here. And 3 over here and 2 over here. Now, 3 over here and 2 over here. Okay? Got everyone?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So, why? Now, what is 1 plus 1? Riyansh?
1 plus 1 is 2.
Okay. So, you know, there is y raised to 1. So, y square. Denominator is also same, so by 2. Then you write over here the limits 2 and 3. Now, what you do in the final step is this This upper limit you put over here. See, basically, if you have this and this, what you do is 3 square minus 2 is bottom here. So 2 square divided by 2. Got it?
Yes, sir.
And then you can get the values. That is what I mean when I say limits.
Okay, sir.
So, actually we have completed integration now. But let me give you a question. Ajinkya, have you got everything? You're not replying from a long time. Ajinkya, am I audible? Okay, let's move on. Right now, find the area bound by the curve which is a graphical representation. Which is a graphical representation of a function fx is equal to 4x cubed plus 3x square plus 2x plus 1. Find the area bound by the curve which is the graphical representation of the function fx is equal to 4x cubed plus 3x square plus 2x plus 1 with the x-axis between the values x is equal to 0 and x is equal to 5. What the question, everyone? Riyansh, did you get the question? Ajinkya, did you get the question? Solve it. I'm giving you some time. Solve the question. It may sound like a bit deep, but at the end of the day, it is very simple. It's just integration only. No one got it? Okay, then let me explain. Anyone got the answer or do you want me to explain? Riyansh, did you get the answer?
Can you explain? I was not able to do.
Could hear you, come again?
Sir, can you explain? I'm not able to do this one.
Okay, fine. So what they're asking is, find the area bound by, there's a curve. Which represents this function, 4x cubed plus 3x squared plus 2x plus 1. So I told you at the beginning that integration is basically the area under a curve.
Yes, sir.
And you know that y is also fx. So what it's asking is the area bound by the curve with the x-axis. So for example, it's not, but let me take an example what to make you understand. If there was this line, say it was y is equal to 3x, and if they asked you to find the area bound between 0 and 5, then basically what you have to do is integrate. See, this is not a curve, it's a triangle, you can easily figure it out. If it was a curve, then you would have done integration of 3x dx. Then you would have gone. So in this case, let's see. So basically what you have to do is the area bound between x and 5. It is basically nothing but put the limit 0 and 5. And write 4x cubed plus 3x square plus 2x plus 1 dx. Basically, this is what the question is asking. Okay?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
From here you find out, so this will be, you know that if there are two functions, the fx and gx, you will add them, means this will be 4x cubed dx plus 3x squared dx plus 2x dx plus 1x. And then everywhere, 0, 1, 0, 1, 0, 1, oh sorry, 5. 0, 5, 0, 5, 0, 5, 0, 1. Okay? Okay, now. So let me take it in parts. The first part. 4x cubed will be 4. Now, 4 you can get out, as I know, as I told you. So, let me do something else. 4 into x cubed dx plus 3 into x squared dx, 2 into x dx plus integration of dx. Because 1, if I keep out, it will be the same. And all with limit 0, 5, 0, 5, 0, 5, 0. Now you know how to solve. X cubed will be x raised to 3 plus 1 by 3 plus 1, which will be 4x, 4. So you keep this and then you write here the limit 0 and 5. Similarly, 3 will be x cubed by 3. Here 0 and 5. Then you write 2 into x raised to 2 by 2, 0 and 5. Integration of dx is actually x. Because why is it so simple? Integration of 1 dx, and you know from exponents and powers, x raised to 0 is 1. So basically, when I'm doing integration of dx, I'm doing integration of x raised to 0 into dx, which you know will be x raised to 0 plus 1 by 0 plus 1, which will be x raised to 1 divided by 1, which will be x. And finally, x with 0 and 5 limits. So that is what it means. Then you can find the values, which will be 4 into 5 raised to 4 minus 0 raised to 4 by 4 plus 3 raised to 5 raised to 3 minus 0 raised to 3 by 3. Then 2 raised to 5 square minus 0 square by 2 plus 5 minus 0. Now you can find out. This is how you will go about the questions. Okay? Got a Rayansh? Got a Jinkya? How if I have a certain function, I can find its integrals? Got it? Both of you are unmuting and not speaking.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so we have some time. This is in fact the end of integrals. Let us start with the concept of vectors. Now, vectors. There are two types of quantities, everybody. Scalar quantities and vector quantities. What is the difference? Scalar quantities possess only magnitude. For example, let's say I have a car. This is my car. If I'm saying that it is going with a speed of 10 kilometer or 100 kilometer per hour, this is a scalar quantity, S-C-A-L-A-R. It possesses only magnitude. But if I say that it is going at the speed of 100 kilometer per hour in this direction, where I specify the direction, it's called vector. But remember, if in school they'll tell you this only, in 7th, 8th, they'll tell you this only, that vector quantity has both magnitude and direction, scalar has only magnitude. But that is not enough. For example, when you study later, you'll figure out that electric current, it possesses both magnitude and direction. But it's not a vector quantity, scalar quantity. So there is one more criterion which is followed by vector quantities. What is that criterion? That criterion is the triangular law of vector addition. But before I go on to what is the triangular law of vector addition, let me tell you this. If I have, say, this point A, and there's a vector like this, let's say this point is B. A is called the tail of the vector, and the direction in which the vector is headed, its terminal point, you can say, that is called the head of the vector, where the arrow lies. So, in this case, tail is A, head is B. Okay? Now, what exactly is the triangular law? Is if I have such a vector, I have this other vector, then the resultant, I'll mark it with another chalk. The resultant of both of these is this vector. What did you do? Simple. For finding, how can you do? This was the head of the vector. This was the tail of the vector. If you know this is the case, then if when you join the tail and that head, means this way, this will be the, this is the, in the case of triangle law of vector addition. Vectors, now, that was for triangular law. Basically, that is not, that does not have anything else to say. Any vector means it is represented, for example, if this is a vector, then we write it like this. And its magnitude is written, either you can simply write it as F, or you can write it as F with the bar, and then two vertical lines enclosing the F. So this is how you represent a normal vector. This is how you represent the magnitude. Now what I say is, vectors are not added like 3 plus 5. They're not added algebraically. They're added with certain rules. What are those rules? Let's see. So let me take any two vectors. Vector A and vector B. See, even if it was upward, that doesn't matter whether I'm representing it. It will always be represented in this way only. So you know by the triangle law. Yeah, I'll extend that a little bit. This should be A vector plus B vector. So that is what is for that. But how we add vectors is a bit more complicated. Since you know that that is A vector and B vector, what I can do is something which we call in physics parallel transportation of vectors. Means if my vectors were apart, if A was here, B was somewhere here. So what I do is, without changing the dynamics of the vector, bringing it this side and then bringing it down. That's called parallel transportation. Don't change the dynamics. Just bring it here and then bring it here. So that is basically what is A vector and B vector transportation. Now, forget that and let's say I've already joined it now. Let's say I bring another form of B here and another form of A here. So what shape have I enclosed is a parallelogram, as you know. And then you know that diagonal is A plus B. Now, suppose, as I said, the magnitude me are the vector sizes. Let me say that the magnitude of A vector is just small a. Magnitude of vector B is just small b. Okay? If that is the case, then let me extend it a bit more. Let me extend what we got from here a bit. So now you already know, I'll write them inside if I have to. Let me extend this line and say that this angle is theta. Let's say that angle is theta and this angle is alpha. Alpha, okay? So let's say that angle is alpha. Now let me write some points. A, B, C, D, E. Let's say these are my points. Now, okay, let me drop P over here. Let's say this is theta again. Okay. Now you know AD square is equal to AE square plus BE square. By the Pythagorean theorem, you know that. Then, AE. Now we go for the expansion. First of all, let me see how more can I distinguish that. AE, as you can see, is AB plus BE. So AB plus BE, the whole square, plus BE, the whole square. Again. So, what I can see over here is AB, you know the magnitude of A vector is A. So, A. Now coming to BE. So I told you, if this is theta, if that is theta, we know that this is B. First I told you that this is B because this shows B vector and the length of this will be B. I told you that if this is theta, then this sleeping one will be B cos theta and this standing one will be B sin theta. So BE from my figure will be B cos theta whole square. Now DE. D is B sin theta. B sin theta the whole square will be B square sin square theta. Now you know we learned that if I have any two numbers capital A and capital B, their square will be capital A whole square plus capital B the whole square plus 2 into capital A into capital B. So similarly, let's look at here. So A plus B cos theta the whole square will be A square plus B square cos square theta plus 2AB cos theta and B square sin square theta remains the same. Now let me keep A square and 2AB cos theta aside. You can see that this is B square into cos square theta plus sin square theta. And you also know from trigonometry that cos square theta plus sin square theta is, Riyansh, what is it? Cos square theta plus sin square theta. It is 1, correct? We learned in trigonometry that this should be 1. Right?
Yes, sir.
So, this will be A. So, this will be B square into 1. So, finally, you'll get as A square plus B square plus 2AD cos theta. But, AD, you know, is A plus B. And let the magnitude of A plus B, let it be something. Let it be, we don't know yet. So, let's say it is something. So the magnitude of A plus B, that means A plus B magnitude. See, you know that AD square is A plus B the magnitude the whole square. So you know that A plus B the magnitude the whole square is A square plus B square plus 2AB cos theta. That means the magnitude of A plus B itself will be the root of A square plus B square plus 2AB cos theta. Very important formula. That is one thing. And second, you can also make out from the image, from the diagram, that alpha is equal to tan inverse d sine theta divided by a plus b cos theta. These two equations are the first equation when you deal with vectors and the first important ones. Fine? Fine, Rayansh? Fine, Ajinkya? How we came about the magnitude of the addition of any two vectors?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So basically, you can see what we did is whenever we have to see what a rule is when we are adding any two vectors, we have a certain rule to follow. What that rule is what I'm going to tell you now. So, like, you should always, if this is a vector, and this is the other vector, always join the head of the other to the tail of the other, and then this one will be the result. And these two formulae, you know now, they are the most important formulae as well for now. Now that was for addition of two vectors. If I want to subtract two vectors also, that is also not exactly, again, it's not algebraic, of course, but there's no divergence exactly we have to follow from our roots. What we did in the first case, you know, is if I'm kind of tilting the diagram or something, this was B vector, this was A vector. B and A. So if I extend B to this side, what I will get is minus B. That is minus B. And you know that this angle is theta. Now, again, let me do parallel transportation. This is minus B only. And this is A. So if I join these, I get A of A plus minus B. Let me write over A plus of minus B is nothing but A minus B. So this will be A minus B if I draw the diagonal. And as you can see, this is a straight line. So this angle will be 180 minus theta or pi minus theta. So in this case, what the sum of the vectors A and minus B, or the subtract or the difference between two vectors A and B. Here it will be root of A square plus B square plus 2AB into cos of, now hold on, it's not theta again. They are enclosing an angle pi minus theta. So the magnitude will be nothing but A square plus B square minus 2AB cos theta. Why? You know, cos of pi minus theta is minus cos theta. That's for addition and subtraction of vectors. Fine? Fine, everyone? If you're fine with this, then we'll proceed with the quiz. Rehansh, do you have any doubts?
No, sir.
Ajinkya, you? Do you have any doubts?
No.
Okay, good. Both of you don't have any doubts. That makes my job easier. Then let's start with the quiz. Today is a day when we are on time with our teacher. So, one more thing is, in fact, not exactly teaching, but if you know, let's say, see, we only dealt with planar. We dealt with planes. If we have what we call the system, when we have x and y graph, is a rectangular Cartesian system. But we have another kind of configuration. That configuration is a z-axis, which, okay. So what is the z-axis? Take your hand, okay? And let's say this is an imaginary y-axis. This is my x-axis. So if you curl your fingers, now since there'll be a bit of reflection on my side, you do it yourself at home. If you curl your fingers inward, if you curl your x-axis inward to your y-axis, the direction only with the right hand, only with the right hand. And don't do it this way. Don't try to break your knuckles. I don't want to do that. I'm teaching you. I don't want to break your knuckles because that'll not help you write. So curl your x-axis inwards into your y-axis. The direction in which your thumb points is the direction in which the z-axis is. So in this, if you look, if I curl my x-axis in front of my y-axis, here will be the z-axis. Okay?
Yes, sir.
So you learned about the distance formula of in coordinate geometry, that you have, if you have any points, x1, y1, and x2, y2. X2, y2. You know that the distance between them will be x2 minus x1 whole square plus y2 minus y1 whole square. But since we are now dealing with under the root, but if I have a vector enclosed between these two points, the magnitude of that vector will also be the length of this line, which will be x2 minus x1 whole square plus y2 minus y1 whole square. But since I have a vector point to deal with, and we also have to add the z coordinates, we will write z2 minus z1 whole square also. And one more thing is, see, we have certain unit vectors in the directions x, y, and z. So the unit vectors are those vectors whose magnitude is 1, 1. So the unit vector in the direction of the x-axis is referred to as I cap, I, and then a kind of bridge kind of symbol. Then we have j, and then a bridge kind of symbol. For z, we have k and a bridge kind of symbol. So, for example, if I have a vector enclosed between the points 1, comma 2, comma 3 and 4, comma 5, comma 6, what we can write that vector is actually 4 minus 1, 4 minus 1 I cap plus 5 minus 2 j cap plus 6 minus 3 k cap. And in fact, that vector is 3 I cap plus 3 j cap plus 3 k cap. And what you do to find the magnitude is easy. You just do root of 3 square plus 3 square plus 3 square, you get. And then what is in this case is that when you're representing a vector in I cap, j cap, k cap, you have to do the difference. See, because in magnitude, you're eventually squaring it. So you know it ought to be positive. But when you're doing it in I cap and j cap, it should always be from the head coordinates to the tail coordinates. Remember that, okay? So equipped with that knowledge, let's go on with our quiz. What is the time? It is 2:07. Great. So let's start with a quiz in some. All of you got it? How we deal with vectors and how we deal with integrals?
Yes, sir.
Yes, we got it.
Okay, then. I'll release the quiz. So the quiz link I'm sharing in the chat. Join this link. So when there are two people, there is maximum competition. Who will win? Is it Riyansh Kabra or Ajinkya Mahajan? So have you two joined? Only one person, Riyansh, has joined. Ajinkya, join. Okay, when you have joined. So this is the war between the two people who attended the class which I had with least amount of attendance. That is like, it is shocking, it's bad. But still, for the competition and quiz, it brings a lot of fun. So, ready for the battle, Vadu? The fierce battle which you two will fight, are you ready? And let's start. All the best to all competitors. Ajinkya with a double lead of 1960 points. Riyansh still at zero. Come on, Riyansh, catch up. Here, Riyansh answers another question, but still his score is zero. 2920 for Ajinkya right now. And Riyansh with the first correct answer, 970 points. Ajinkya gets the question wrong, but there's a lead of less than 2000 points, 1950 points to be exact, between Ajinkya and Riyansh. Ajinkya takes another lead, 3900 points, Riyansh still at 970. Okay, another question got wrong, loser is streak. Both of them have lost their streak. And okay, join from another account. I'll delete this account of yours. See, go to the chat box again, go to the Google Meet chat box and click the link which you have again, and don't write Riyansh, write some other name of yours. You said you got disconnected, right? Or are you still in the quiz?
Sir, I had some net problem, I got disconnected here.
Okay, so I'm deleting that account of yours. I'm deleting that account, then you click that link in the chat box again.
Yes,
and then you can write another name. Don't write just Riyansh, write Riyansh Kabra or something.
Okay, sir.
So 3900 Ajinkya's points due to some internet connection issues. Riyansh had to join again. Let's see if he gets the lead. 3900 still for Ajinkya. He got the question wrong. Another question wrong for Ajinkya. Riyansh has not answered a question yet, but answered the first question. Riyansh has got 0 points. Ajinkya still 3900. Big lead, which Riyansh has to come to.
F5 and I am joining one more, like other account of it.
So I'll delete your other account. Okay.
Yes, you can.
890 points for Rayansh. But will he catch up to Jinkya and steal the show at the end of the day?
I think.
Oh. Ready for that? Ajinkya, you pressed again over. Ajinkya, do you have some network issues because you are stuck at 3900 and another account joined?
No, no, I am back.
Points. Just a minute. Yeah, Ajinkya? You were saying something, Ajinkya? Unmute. Unmute yourself.
Yes, I was having some internet problem, but it has, like, I'm back now.
So you are in two accounts right now. Which one should I remove? The one which has only
Ajinkya Mahajan, you can cut that one.
So your new account should be there.
Yes.
Okay. Ryansh in the 2720 league. Okay, another answer was wrong. 970 for Ajinkya. Both of them have new accounts and a very healthy atmosphere is in the game. 1950 for Ajinkya right now. Another wrong answer for Ajinkya. 3600, Ryan checks another correct answer. Ajinkya answered the question but yet wrong and is still not able to cope up with the score of Ryansh. He gets another question. 2920 for Ajinkya. Ajinkya gets another question wrong, and Ryansh is, I believe, still answering another question. Ajinkya gets the lead for the first time. 290 points. Very good margin. Ryansh gets the seed again. 4520. A very, very nip and tuck competition going on. We'll have to see who will win. 5490 points. Another, oh, I think that's 900 points for Ryansh. Ajinkya, 3890. 4490. More points for Ajinkya. Very tight battle. 1000 points. That's the only difference between both of these two. 5440. 50 points. 6430. Ryansh gets those many points. 6430 again. Both of them got the next question of their long. They have to wait and watch who finally gets the game. 30 points difference between Ryansh and Ajinkya. I think Ajinkya gets to 6400. This is crazy. This is one of the best classes. 7350 for Ryansh and Ajinkya still 6400. Will Ajinkya see the show at the end of the day or Ryansh get it? Both of them have answered the same amount of questions. Ryansh answers one more question, he gets that wrong. Ajinkya again, Ajinkya also answers another question, he gets that one wrong. Ryansh and Ajinkya, 7350, 7380, 30 point lead for Ajinkya. Will Ryansh redeem himself? 7380 still for Ajinkya. He has just, I think, one or two questions left to answer. But only a 30 point lead. Ryansh does have a chance to sweep it. 7380 Ajinkya has ended his game, but You have one question left, Shreyansh. You can take it at the end of the day. Will he do it? Or will there be something else in the result? There's 30 more points. Shreyansh takes the lead in the end by just how many? That's just a bit more than 500, a bit less than 600 points, 570 points to be exact. And that's the end of it. They were all at the same, means it was first Ajinkya going up, then Shreyansh going up, then both of them being at a tied level. But at the end, by just a few points, Shreyansh did take with the last question. That is what I call an amazing match. But clap to all of you, amazing. So amazing scores. And the winner, Shreyansh Kabra. Okay, so let us see the accuracy. Accuracy 52 and 47. Well, even in accuracy, Shreyansh was just a tad more than Ajinkya. Now let us see the longest and toughest questions. Okay, so this was not gotten by any person. So let me explain. This required integration and so I will explain this, don't worry. But let's see what was the other question, the longest question. And find I minus C. This is easy. This is, you can take sine square x by cos square x. Means sec square x is 1 by cos square x. Cosec square x is 1 by sine square x. So ultimately, that will become sine square x by cos square x. And tan square x. And then you can use your trigonometry knowledge, which you have learned. And then you can say it is sec, using that equation, I think it is sec square x is equal to tan square x plus 1. And then you'll get tan square x as sec square x minus 1. And then you will be able to express tan square x. And then you'll slowly get what exactly will be I minus C, where C is a constant of integration. At present, a firm is manufacturing 2000 items. That was the toughest question. So let's see how we can go about it. See, so basically what you can do is, they have said that at present, a firm is manufacturing 2000 items, and it is estimated that the rate of change of production P with respect to the additional workers is given by dp by dx is 100 minus 12 root x. So what you can do is,
Ajinkya left the meeting.
Okay, fine. So this is anyways getting recorded, and still we can understand this when we'll see the, but let's see if you can understand. So dp by dx is given as 100 minus 12 root x in that question. I'll go back to that question. Yeah, so it is given that dp by dx is 100 minus 12 root x. Dx you get up, so it will become dp is equal to 100 minus 12 root x, and integrate all sides. Let's say that the, what the question is asking is the new level of production of items. So it first starts with 2000 items, right? So the lower limit is 2000, upper limit is, let's say it is P, okay? So it will be like integration dP, down you write 2000, up you write P, say. And then it says that, what does it say? If the firm employs 25 more workers. So initially they have not said there were no new workers. So what you can do is integration of 100 minus 12 root x and then dx, which is said as with respect to x. Otherwise, you write from 0 to 25, the limits. Getting me?
Yes, sir.
Can you, okay, fine. I'll write it on a notebook and show you. So I know you were not getting me. So they have given that dp by dx is 100 minus 12 root x. So you can write this, right? dp is equal to 100 minus 12 root x into dx.
Yes, you can.
And then I can integrate. So they have said that initially they have 2000. What is the question? At present, a firm is manufacturing 2000 items. So the lower limit will be 2000, right? Then they're asking new level of items. So let me say it is P, capital P, like this, okay?
Okay, sir.
Now they are saying that they employed 25 new workers. So initially they employed zero new workers. The change is zero.
How
And then
so?
they, huh?
How did the,
If the firm employs 25 more workers,
yes,
DX
ma'am.
is basically change in X. So there was no change in X before they employed the new workers.
I
So
got
it
it.
was zero, right?
Yes, I got it.
And then the upper limit will be 25. Why? Because they employed 25 more workers.
Yes, sir.
So you'll get it like this.
Yes, sir. Yeah.
So integration of DP will be 2000 minus P with the limits. See, because integration of DP you know is P,
Yes,
right?
sir. Yes, sir.
And then it'll be two, since we have limits over here, it'll be 2000 minus P, okay?
Yeah.
Not 2000 minus P, just a minute. Oh, sorry. Upper limit minus lower limit. Now, nah, sorry. P minus 2000. Now, P minus 2000. And then they are saying 100 minus 12 root x dx. Simply, what you do is integration of 100 dx from 0 to 25. I'll write that down just a minute. Minus integration of, now, root x you know is x raised to 1 by 2
Yes, sir.
dx with the same limits. I'm getting something like this. Fine.
Okay, sir.
Now, P minus 2000 is equal to 100. I can take out, it's a constant.
Yeah.
And 0 and limits 25 dx. Similarly, 12 I can take out. And then
Yes.
x raised to 1 by 2.
Sir. So your pause, your screen is pause on my. Hello? I can't hear you. Sir, your screen is paused. Hello?
Am I
Yes, sir.
audible, visible?
Sir, you're all okay. Yes, sir. Now it's clear.
Yeah. Yeah, I lost it for that. Okay. So 100 like this you got, and 12 is a constant, right?
Yes, sir, it is.
And x raised to 1 by 2 dx, I can write. Limit 0 to 25.
Yes, sir.
Now. So you'll get this as P minus 2000 is equal to 100 into upper limit minus lower limit 25 minus 0
Yes, sir.
minus now x raised to 1 by 2 dx. So 1 by 2 plus 1 is 3 by 2, right?
Yes, sir.
So it will be 12 into x raised to 3 by 2 divided by 3 by 2. And when you divide something by 3 by 2, what you're doing is multiplying by 2 by 3, correct?
Sir.
And you're putting these from 0 to 25 like this. P minus 2000 remains intact, correct?
Yes, sir.
Integration of dx will be 25 minus 0, so 100 into 25 minus 0, right?
Yes, sir.
Minus 12, constant remains outside.
Yeah.
So x raised to 3 by 2, 1 by 2 plus 1, x raised to n dx is x raised to n plus 1, right?
Okay, sir. Yes, sir.
And when you divide it by 3 by 2, you're multiplying it with 2 by 3. So 2, 3 down and 2 here. Fine.
Okay, sir.
And the limits, and like we write it like this, a vertical big line from 0 to 25.
Okay,
Okay.
sir. Okay, yes, sir.
So 100 into 25, you know, is 2500.
Yes, sir.
Minus now 12 into 2 by 3 will be 8,
Okay, sir.
and x raised to 3 by 2. So that will mean 8 into 25 raised to 3 by 2 minus 0 raised to 3 by 2 because the limits are like that, right?
Yes, sir.
See, like this 2500, 20, 100 into 25 minus 0,
Okay, sir.
then 2500 minus now. Don't look at this.
12 was here into 2 by 3. So yes, you got 8, right?
Yeah, yes.
8. And into 25 raised to 3 by 2, upper limit, minus 0 raised to 3 by 2, lower limit.
Yes, sir.
So you will get 2500. Minus, now 25 raised to 1 by 2 is 5 because root of 25.
Yes, sir, yeah.
And 25 raised to 3 is, 5 raised to 3 is 125.
Yes,
5
sir.
Into 5 is 25, yeah. And 8 into 125, 1000.
Yes, sir.
So you get the equation T minus 2000 is 2500 minus 1000.
Yes, sir.
Then you will say that P is equal to 2000 plus 2500 minus 1000. So here they have taken A. So we'll replace P with A in the end. Don't worry. Okay.
Okay, sir.
So 2000 plus 2500 minus 1000 will mean 3500.
Yes, sir. It will be, sir.
So A is equal to 3500. Now they're asking determine the value of 2A by 1000. So 2 into 3500 will be 7000.
Yes, yeah, yes, sir, yes, sir.
And 7000 by 1000 is 7.
Yes, sir, yeah, it is.
So that will be the answer. Got it?
Okay, so the answer is 7, right?
Yeah, the answer is 7.
Okay, sir.
Okay, then. Thank you, bye.
Bye, sir.
Bye.